Steve, you hit it out of the park with this book. I couldn't put it down. Very cool. What inspired you to write this book now?
I think the simplest way to say it is, I've known since 2014 the Black Crowes were done, and at least my involvement in the Black Crowes. And when the band blew up in 2014, that was never going to sit right as far as how that happened. I definitely wasn't crazy about the way that the story was spun. But all said, I was for a few years after that, I was very busy with Trigger Hippie, with my radio show at that time, Steve Gorman Sports. I have a family. I have all these things that are keeping me going. And then in November of 16, almost 3 years ago, Ed Harsh died. And when he died, it was I thought I had already gone as far as I could go with the sense of finality where the Black Crowes are. The whole story of the band was done, long since done. It made sense to me. I wasn't crazy about it. It's a very sad story in my opinion, but I understood it. And then Ed's death brought a surprising new sense of finality, if you will. Like, as far as when everyone says the final nail in the coffin, well, Ed, moving on to the next realm was definitely that. And it wasn't a conscious thought of it's time to write a book now. But at the time, I did write a eulogy for Ed on my radio show. I opened my show that night with about a 12-minute, segment about Ed. I mean, it was essentially my eulogy. And as I was writing it that day, it made sense to me I wrote way more than I needed. I had a lot to say. And then over the next few months following that, it kind of occurred to me, I had this needling thing. And one day I finally went, I think I want to write a book now, but it just took, I was like the last guy to probably put that together, but that's what led to it. And then I just started and I thought, well, I'll write and see if I stop. And the more I started writing, the more I kept writing. And it was pretty obvious within a few weeks, like, I think I'm actually going to do this.
I was really struck by, there's some amazing laugh out loud moments. There's some deeply personal moments in this. And I wondered for you, I thought you were pretty brave talking about issues around some of the conflicts in the band, mental health issues, addiction issues. What was it like for you emotionally going back through some of these stories and writing them?
A few times it was very difficult. The way my memory works, it's pretty linear. I have a strong attention to detail, I guess, that doesn't seem to strike me in real time, but it's all back in the back of my head somewhere. And there were a few moments. The stuff that was the hardest to write were the few things that I had never really dealt with. For instance, there's a chapter about Sven and some of the problems he had. That was far and away the hardest thing for me to write. And I think the reason is when Sven and I reconnected in the band a few years after that fact, we never really talked about it. We didn't have to. Our relationship's solid. We like and respect each other. And he was in a good place, and I was just thrilled to see that he was in a good place, and we just got on with it. And as I was writing it, I think I became aware of the fact that, wow, he and I never really went over this, Yeah. And it was at the time, there was a sadness and a devastating impact on me, which went beyond the Black Crowes. It went back to the fact that Sven was the guy that I moved to Atlanta to start a band with, and he and another friend, Clint, it struck me in that regard, and it brought up a level of sadness about those guys and that original concept that I hadn't thought about in years when I was writing it. Because when I'm writing these stories, I know what everyone's wearing. I can remember what the room smelled like. I know what everybody was eating or drinking or whatever. And so it is a pretty it's all inclusive, all of it comes back. And so while I can't say any of it was fun, I really did enjoy the process. I got a lot out of it. The cathartic thing for me was in a linear way. I'd already dealt with, I think, 90% of the emotional stuff already. I'd already, I've been in therapy and I've been doing a lot of self-examination, and I've looked at myself primarily as, well, what did I do to bring this on? How did I handle it? What can I do better? My main point in life is just trying not to repeat mistakes. I'm still making them and I will, but I just don't want to repeat them. I did a lot of repeating of mistakes when I was a young man in this band. So the best thing I got from the book was just that sense of this couldn't have gone any other way. This is literally, this was how it was going to be. And it's real clear to me now. And just having a document of it, a record of it written out, was helpful in that regard.
Can we talk a little bit more about that? I mean, you were very open and honest and explicit with some of the conflicts in the band, interpersonal issues, mental health and addiction, your own struggles, like you talked sure. about in Japan, the struggles with the brothers Robinson and the rest mm-hmm. of the band. Can we talk about what sort of lessons have you been learning from all of this?
Well, you know, there's a lot to be said, both good and bad, for being the kind of person that says, "Oh, let me help. I can, you know, let me take care of this. I'll do it." You know, taking on more than you actually are equipped to take on. You know, I'm all about go team. You know, it's like, hey, jump on. You know, in my mind, we were a basketball team, and I was happy to play defense and rebound. You know, I didn't need to dunk ever. I was just, you know. Not everybody sees the world. It took me a really long time to accept the very simple fact that everybody looks at this band very differently. I had this assumption, and it's easier to do as a local band. Well, we're all on the same page. We're all showing up to rehearse. We're all playing gigs. We all want the same things. And then as the band's, you know, as it took off with the first album, and once there was all these external elements, it's plain as day that we were not on the same page, that everybody saw the band differently. Everybody wanted different things, but I couldn't accept that for, you know, the first 5-6 years of the band's existence. I just could not get my head around that. And the biggest problem I had was just simply admitting that I was struggling. I mean, how can I be struggling? I got this together. I'm smart and I know who I am. And this is not my problem. And, you know, that's the worst possible way to go into anything, you know, like everybody. Now, there was also a fear of expressing vulnerability because you'd get killed in the Black Crows. Right. Everybody had their own battles to fight internally. And I only really speak to mine because that's the only one I really have an understanding of. But, you know, but I had just like the band, you know, I had great strengths and I had great weaknesses. And a lot of times they look very similar. And it's just a matter of a conversation going a little too far around the bend before I could recognize one, you know, am I the strong person here or am I the weak link? And they can be, it can be really confusing. And familiarity in a family with addiction, in a band with addiction, any situation that has addiction is invariably going to have codependency. You get this mix of people who all are in the room together, and as toxic as it can be, it becomes very familiar, and then that works its way into your brain as being comfortable. There's a difference between familiar and comfortable. Right. And when you lose sight of that difference, which everybody in our world did pretty early on, you're just kind of a clown car at that point. I mean, you know, you have your great moments. We could still make great music, right. But the way we interacted, the way we dealt with each other, the way we dealt with our band as a, you know, our career, the way we handled pretty much everything became, you know, it was inefficient, ineffective, it was negative, and it was very tense and difficult. Yeah.
You know, and I was also struck by your manager at the time, who basically, who was your Peter Grant of the Black Crowes, Pete
Absolutely.
Angelus. Yeah. Pete Angelus gave you a real gift as far as recommending a book of real self-awareness at some point that you chose to take.
Yeah, and we talked a lot about, you know, that I mentioned that in the book. That was hardly the first time we'd had a conversation about what was going on. And there were conversations very early on about alcoholism and addiction and what that looks like and what it does to the people around who care. But, you know, it's a hard thing to look at someone you've decided you're going to love and support and always have his back and go, he's an addict. That was very hard for me to do. It was very hard for a lot of people to do. No matter what they do, because then you say, well, what does that say about me that I'm just here? I mean, none of this is conscious linear thought at the time when you're in your 20s and everything you ever wanted is happening. It's right. just all yeah. blowing up and there's all these things. But like I said, before you know it, familiarity gives way to comfort, gives way to this is just who we are. This is how we are. There's nothing I can do about it. And I was drinking like a fish for the first part of the, you know, by the time we hit 94, 95, and things were getting really, really, really traumatic for everybody. I was drinking just to stay, keep my head together. And I never went back to the depths that I had hit in Japan in 1992. But my way of not doing that was to just shut down and check out and not allow myself to feel so much. So I had all kinds of issues myself, you know. And I think that Pete, I talked with Pete a lot over the years. There were several really big conversations that ultimately they all added up to me finally just accepting a lot of things. There's an entire, I basically in Japan, I hit a wall. I write about this in the book. I would say, for lack of a better term, I pretty much had a nervous breakdown. Oh, I had another one in 1998 that didn't make the final edit. That one really wasn't about the Black Crowes at all. That was about everything else that I had put away to just deal with being in the Black Crowes. It was, you know, by that point I was 33. And I think most people, by the time they're 33, they've been on their own. I mean, a lot of people anyway, they've had an opportunity to look at their own life and their own perspective and view it through their own lens. And I was at a place where I was like, I got to make sense of things from my childhood. I need to make sense of things from, you know, I was married and I'm looking at my wife at times and we're just not even connecting because I can't express myself in a linear fashion anymore. There was a lot going on. And when I really kind of unwound in 1998, it was the best thing that ever happened to me because I really let everything go and recognized, okay, the Black Crowes is what I do. It's not who I am. If the Black Crowes is who I am, I need to go jump off a bridge right now because this band is not going to last forever. I have to know that there's something beyond this band. But it's embarrassing to admit that to people when you're supposedly the voice of reason and you're the logical one. And I'm just as obsessed and mindlessly committed to this thing. And I'm going against my own gut instinct a lot, you know, and when I talk about not making mistakes for this, you know, not repeating mistakes, I'll make mistakes. What I won't do again is things that I know very clearly I shouldn't do. My lowest points when I look back as a member of the Black Crowes were the moments when I gave in against my own better judgment. You know, the better angels of my nature were singing loud and clear. Yeah. And I ran out of the energy to support myself and said, fine, whatever. Right. And those are the ones, those are the things that you wake up in the middle of the night and go, oh, fuck. Right. You know, I mean, making an earnest, honest effort and screwing up, well, whatever.
Right.
That's normal. That's healthy if you're smart enough to admit it. And for a long time, I wasn't smart enough to admit those things.
Right. Yeah, and I think it's fantastic. Obviously, I love the music. I love your drumming, but it's fantastic to hear the work you've been doing, the self-awareness. Before we move on to other things, because you're a busy guy, you got a lot of projects, and I want to take some questions from the folks who are watching as well. If I read correctly in the book, you haven't spoken to Chris or Rich in quite a while since the band broke up.
I haven't spoken to Chris since 2014. I haven't spoken to Rich since right after Ed passed. And that was just it's just silly business. You know, we were very much in communication for the first 2 years after the band broke up. Okay. But we had a conversation where I was trying to get, there was some business things to attend to. And he was holding back information from me that I was surprised to find out. I thought we had worked through that shit and that he at least understood the strategic value of staying aligned with me in Black Crowes business. And to be very direct, he just lied to me about something that I already knew. And I gave him three opportunities to not do that. And he went 3 for 3. And I said, well, you know what this means? We're done now. And I've never spoken to him since.
Yeah. No reaching out on either side. If you were to talk to him, what would you say?
I haven't even thought about it. I don't know what the circumstance would be that would make me want to give him a call. It's not out of any reason other than my life is much better without either one of them in it. That's how I see it. I would imagine they probably say the same about me. I mean, it's fine. You know, there's pretty much everybody that was ever in the band all can see, you know, everybody, you know, I have a relationship with just about everybody. Anybody I was ever close with, I'm still close with. Yeah. everybody has their own varying degree of relationship with the Robinson brothers. They're very unique. They do, you know, I see them as the same person with very different surface, you know, they're different on the surface. Yeah. They're very much alike beyond that. And, you know, they're, it's not an unusual thing. I would hardly be the only guy to say what I'm saying now, which is I deal with everybody but them.
Yeah, and sometimes just like ex-girlfriends, relationships are best left alone, right? And not turned over.
There's like when I say this, it's not out of anything. There's nothing to say. It's all been said.